Hello students, welcome to EBC Pathshala. I'm Dr. Joginder Singh from Kurukshetra University, Kurukshetra. Today we are going to talk on module Information Seeking Behavior, Concept and Methods from paper Library Use and User Study. According to Samuel Johnson, 1709 to 1784, knowledge is of two kinds. We know our subject ourselves, or we know where we can find information upon it. But what when we do not know where to find it, and we still want information? When information need is felt, the process of information seeking behavior begins. In 1981 and 2005, Wilson suggests the term information needs be abandoned and replaced with the term information seeking behavior. As behavior is observable, whereas needs being internal, mental states are not. After reading this module, you will be able to do the following. To understand the concept of information seeking behavior, to understand the meaning of information, information needs, information behavior, information seeking, information searching behavior, information use behavior, and to identify the various methods of information seeking behavior. Libraries are essential in bridging the gaps that information seekers from various backgrounds may have. They are seen as the gatekeepers of access to knowledge and are liable for disseminating it to fulfill information needs. They can provide the necessary access to all of the information from both within and outside an information seeker's field. Through the years, people of all professions have been searching for information needed for various reasons. In the past, this has been done through books, magazines, journals, conferences, and meetings, to mention a few sources. The current information environment is rich, characterized by a proliferation of information sources and providers, a multiplicity of methods for accessing information, and redundancy of content from multiple sources. And this overloaded information environment, many information users tend to experience a sense of information inadequacy and anxiety. And this complex information environment, insight into information seeking can be gained by understanding how users seek information sources and how they choose content to meet their needs. If you are making a major decision, for example, buying a house or finishing a task by a deadline, for example, writing a report, we might find ourselves in an earnest information seeking mode, that is, talking to others, searching the web, reading magazines, watching the news, and so on. We may do everything we can to satisfy our desire for input until either our need is satisfied or we have run out of time. The sort of curiosity unmotivated by an immediate goal is a common aspect of human life. Importance of information. Information is highly personal and a source of instant power for the information society. It varies from person to person, place to place, and time to time. It eliminates uncertainty and improves quality of life and work. It leads to action and changes a decision. It can be defined as an intangible entity, a commodity, a process, and a critical resource. making information useful. Information can be useful if it is relevant to information need, accurate and up-to-date, complete and widely applicable, derived from reliable resources, easily accessible by creating usable and convenient information systems. Context, personal and situational, is central to the transfer of information. Information seeking isn't always about a problem. It is simply a creative act. Information can be presented in usable format and packages. Barriers and implications to information seeking. There are some barriers and implications to the information seeking behavior of the pupil. Number one, pupil prefer to seek information from other people, particularly from those similar to themselves. The most used information sources are other people, friends, family, colleagues. People do not necessarily classify information as libraries do. Information is given to a person doesn't mean they will use it. People may accept or reject information depending on their mood. Not knowing what information is needed and where to find it. Lack of awareness about existence of sources. Lack of communication skills, self-confidence, and lack of ability to use sources effectively. Inaccurate or inappropriate information. Importance of information seeking behavior. Understanding human information behavior is a vital component in providing high quality library service. People from all walks of life seek out and utilize information every day. Information regarding studies and research, work, entertainment, health, money matters, family and other topics is obtained from various sources. Why people seek information and the types of information they seek in their everyday lives can impact collection development, reference services, programming, and budget allotment practices as given by Augusto and Hegg-Sessel in 2005. Students, in navigating their academic and everyday life, may face more problems. This has to do with their ability to access the most relevant information when they need it and knowing what information they need to make their decisions in a different culture. Traditionally, lot of orientation programs tend to be provided from all around the world with different information needs, so catering each person's need is very difficult, according to Mori 2000. Therefore, it would seem that understanding information seeking behavior is of interest because it can inform educational institutions how best to provide information to students. More importantly, this could help institutions to understand how to help students to improve and develop their information-seeking behavior and to find the most relevant information as they navigate a new complex environment in a timely manner. Until 1980s, most of the studies were concerned with system-based rather than user-based. Since 1980s, studies shift towards person-centered approach, accompanied by a switch from quantitative methods to qualitative methods. The concept of information behavior was coined in the late 1990s and used to include all kinds of research on people's interaction with information. The concept was closely related to the user studies, information use studies, information transfer studies, communication behavior studies, and recently information seeking behavior under digital and web environment attracted more sites. As we have discussed in brief, the historical concept of information seeking behavior, there are two more aspects of information seeking behavior. The first one is subjective aspect and the second one is objective aspect. Subjective aspect is also known as actual behavior of the users. It deals with the library resources, the subject coverage they need, they provide, and the various dissemination techniques employed for their use. It is also known as use studies. And the second one is objective aspects, which is also known as the verbal behavior of the users. It deals with the user's opinion about the adequacy and suitability of those resources, their willingness to use them, and their ability to use the services. It is also known as user study. Thus, a librarian tries to determine what they express, what they like, what they do, what do they need, and why people behave differently. Information seeking behavior. The concept of information behavior mainly related to relationship between users with information, which encompassing information needs of individuals, information seeking behaviors, information use, and user specific properties such as cognitive structure, perception, decision taking, and selection. Thus, meaning of information seeking behavior is motivations plus moves, that is information behavior. Here, motivation means reasons for information seeking, and moves means strategies used to find information. Some definitions are needed before we go further. According to Prasad 1992 of NICE, strategies and actions undertaken to locate knowledge. Further, he contends that the concept is concerned with the interactive utilization of three basic resources, which are people, information, and systems. An individual may follow various paths in trying to satisfy an information need which has arisen. This may entail turning to personal resources, friends, relatives, and acquaintances, or formal information systems such as libraries and community information centers. According to Wilson 2000, information behavior is the totality of human behavior in relation to sources and channels of information, including both active and passive information seeking and information use. Thus, it includes face-to-face communication with others as well as the passive reception of information, as in, for example, watching TV advertisements without any intention to act on the information given. So, we can say that information behavior means the way users seek information, the way they go about finding it, and the way they use it. It is the totality of users' information seeking habits. Information seeking behavior. Information seeking behavior begins when someone realizes the existence of an information need and ends when that need is believed to have been satisfied. The type of information people search for is situational, in that it depends on a need that is linked to a given time and place. This is according to Craig Lass, given in 1983. In 2007, CASE defines information seeking as a conscious effort to acquire information in response to a need, a gap in your knowledge. The process of construction within information seeking involves fitting information in with what one already knows and extending this knowledge to create new perspectives. Thus, information seeking is the process engaged in by humans to change their state of knowledge. Generally, information seeking is not an end itself. Information searching behavior is the micro level of behavior employed by the searcher in interacting with information systems of all kinds. It consists of all the interactions with the system, whether at the level of human-computer interaction, for example, use of the mouse and clicks on links, or at the intellectual level, for example, adopting a Boolean search strategy, or determining the criteria for deciding which of two books selected from adjacent places on a library shelf is most useful, which will also involve mental acts such as judging the relevance of data or information retrieved. Information use behavior. Information use behavior consists of the physical and mental acts involved in incorporating the information found into the person's existing knowledge base. It may involve, therefore, physical acts such as marking sections in a text to note their importance or significance, as well as mental acts that involve, for example, comparison of new information with existing knowledge. Thus, information behavior may be defined as the more general field of investigation, with the information seeking behavior being a subset of the field, particularly concerned with the variety of methods people employ to discover and gain access to information sources. Information searching behavior is then defined as a subset of information seeking behavior, particularly concerned with or without an intermediary and computer-based information systems, of which information retrieval systems for textual data may be seen as one type. This is the model given by Wilson of information-seeking behavior. This model suggests that information-seeking behavior arises as a consequence of a need pursued by an information user, who, in order to satisfy that need, make demands upon formal or informal sources or services, which result in success or failure to find relevant information. If successfully, the individual then makes use of information found and may either fully or partially satisfy the pursued need, or indeed fail to satisfy the need and have to reiterate the search process. It also shows that part of information seeking behavior may involve other people through information exchange, and that information pursued as useful may be passed to other people, as well as being used or instead of being used by the person himself or herself. Phases of information seeking behavior. Information seeking behavior run through different phases. First one is problem and subject. The information need arises when you need to find information to solve a problem. Second one, planning the information retrieval, define the information need, select information sources, search methods, and search words. Third one is implementation of information retrieval. Execute the planned information retrieval, that is information retrieval methods. Fourth one is evaluation of search results. Evaluate the results of information retrieval, number of references, and their accuracy. Next, locating publications. Find out where the publications, that is an article, is located. And the last one is using and evaluating the information. Evaluate the final result, source criticism, and research ethics. After discussing the different phases of information seeking behavior, now let's know about the different factors which can influence the information users. There are different factors which can influence the information need of the users. The first one is kinds of information. What do they want to know? Second, knowledge. What people know, how well they understand something, that is, to what extent do they understand. And the third one is beliefs, attitudes, opinions. To what extent do they feel that their attitude has changed about. And the fourth one is behaviors. What people do change in behavior. The fifth one is attributes. What people are and what people have. And the last one is demographic characteristic. It is based on the age, education, occupation, or income of the users. Now we will see methods of information seeking behavior. There are different methods of information seeking behavior. Broadly, we can characterize the methods of information seeking behavior into two categories. The first one is direct method, and the second one is indirect method. In direct method, we can include interview, observation, focus groups, scenario-based design. And in indirect methods, questionnaires and survey methods, diary methods, citation analysis, analysis of library records, repertory grid analysis, Delphi methods, computer feedback, wikis, blogs, and discussion forums. Direct method of information seeking behavior. The first one is interview method. Interview method. In this method, the interviewer asks questions when he comes in face-to-face contact with the other person or persons. You can have a set of questions asked in a particular order called structured interviews, or you could keep it completely open called unstructured, in which there is no fixed order or questions. Interviews are used to collect self-reported experiences, opinions, preferences, and behavioral motivations and users' satisfactions with the system. This method is more time-consuming, especially when the sample is large and involves high cost of selecting, training, and supervising interviews. Second one is observation method. Observation is one of the important methods which enables to study the behavior of individuals as it occurs. User observation, which is aimed at learning from the direct or indirect observations of users, such as video recording. In the context of real uses, by interviewing and observing users at work while doing their own work. The systematic observation, which can be defined as a particular approach to quantifying behavior. This approach is typically concerned with naturally occurring behavior observed in a real context. This method are most reliable and precise, but they are also very expensive. The next method is focus group. Focus groups are excellent ways to probe users' attitudes, beliefs, and desires. They are good for idea generation, brainstorming, comparing alternative designs. Focus group, which is a structured discussion about specific topics moderated by a trained group leader. A typical focus group session includes from 8 to 12 people and lasts for 2 hours. The people are carefully chosen to represent the potential users of the product. If the potential audience is large, several focus group sessions can be performed. They do not provide information about what users actually do. A focus group should be expected to generate a lot of useful information and ideas. It is suited for use at the early stage of design, but can be used during the whole process. The next one is scenario-based design. A scenario is aimed illustrating a usage situation by showing the user's actions step by step. It can be represented by textual descriptions, images, and videos, and it can be employed in different design phases. Scenarios are stories which show the future. A scenario moves from the past to the future, showing how things work and how people's behavior and preferences change. A scenario makes us think about many levels of interactions at once, including information about the environment, person, and details of screen and input devices, as well as other objects and activities happening. Indirect method, questionnaires, and survey method. Technically, questionnaires are self-reported and thus indirect, whereas surveys are conducted by the researcher and thus direct method. But the terms are often used interchangeably. Most user research tends to use the self-reported form, wherein both the questions and the answers are fixed. Through this method, we study large and small population by selecting and studying samples chosen from the defined population. Questions in a questionnaire can be either open-ended or closed-ended. In a closed-ended question, respondents are offered a set of answers from which they are asked to choose the one that most closely represents their views. In case of open-ended questions, it is not followed by any kind of specified choice and the respondents' answers are recorded in full. The closed-ended questions are easy to ask and can be quickly answered by the respondent. One major disadvantage of this method is that it may introduce bias either by forcing the respondent to choose from given alternatives. The next method is diary method. Diaries provide a first-hand account of the individual life experiences. In this method, individuals under study are asked to keep a detailed record of particular information activities. For example, searching for information, actual reading, discussing with colleagues, library use, etc. for a given period of time. To facilitate the work of recording and the final analysis of data, diary forms are supplied to the users for different activities. It is quite evident that in this method, maximum effort is involved on the part of the users. Many times, the respondents do not record the information item consistently needed in their day-to-day work and can be effective when the population under surveys is necessarily very small. The diary also gives people more time to think about what they feel is important and related to the project team. As diary study explicitly encourages people to look at and think about their lives, it renders them sensitive to the issues in their own context that may be of relevance for a design project. In fact, diaries are a good means for preparing users for project-related interviews. Citation analysis. This method entails the analysis of the bibliographical data that are usually appended with every research practice. Analysis of such citations can reveal useful information like the relative use of different kinds of documents such as books, periodicals, reports, patents, etc. The age of these documents, which reveal the rate of obsolescence of literature, the most frequently used titles of periodicals, sketching of literature, language preferences, etc. within different scientific communities, according to subjects, nationality, etc. This type of information can be utilized for acquisition of materials, selection of periodical titles, and judicious distribution of library funds, and so on. Analysis of library records. Various types of library records have been used by librarians for a long time. Records of reference persons and literature sources can be librarians' inside services. Similarly, circulation records can be analyzed to determine the activity of the library as well as to determine the reading habits of library users. A closely related method is the analysis of the personal indexes used by the researchers. Repertory grid analysis. George A. Cayley developed the repertory grid technique, originally the RAP test, is a very useful method from the field of psychology that can be used to uncover customers' perceptions of products and services and to identify their hidden needs. Customers are asked multiple times to compare and contrast random sets of three products or services which they are familiar with. Each set of three products is presented to them with the same question, which is, in your experience, how are two of these products similar to each other and different from the third? This forces interviewers to think deeply and articulate their views on products or services. Its aim is to describe the ways in which people give meaning to their experience in their own terms. The repertory grid, in its many forms, is a method used to explore the structure and content of the implicit theories, personal meanings through which we can perceive and act in our day-to-day existence. Delphi method. The name Delphi was used by Project Rand during the 1950 to 1960s, particularly in 1959, by Olaf Helmert, Norman Delke, and Nicholas Resser. Delphi defined as an organized method for collecting views and information pertaining to a specific area that allows dialogue between geographically separated experts while serving an effective means for learning, gathering a group of experts to forecast events and assess complex issues, collecting human intelligence. It is a structured communication technique originally developed as a systematic interactive forecasting method which relies on a panel of experts. The experts answer questionnaires in two or more rounds. After each round, a facilitator provides a anonymous summary of the experts' forecast from the previous round as well as the reasons why they provide for their judgment. Thus, experts are encouraged to revise their earlier answers in light of the replies of other members of their panel. It is believed that during this process, the range of the answers will decrease and the group will converge towards the correct answer. Finally, the process is stopped after a predefined stop criteria, for example, number of rounds, achievement of consensus and stability of results, and the mean and median scores of the final rounds determine the results. Wikis, blogs, and discussion forums. The general idea of wikis, blogs, and discussion forums is that anyone having an internet connection can contribute by posting or editing information which has already been posted. In this sense, these technologies gather user opinions, experiences, and practices of users from all over the world. For this reason, wikis, blogs, and discussion forums may be a bountiful source for user requirements or user experience with a particular product or service. After knowing the different methods of information seeking behaviors, there are different hype, myths, and assumptions. Hype. Google is the answer to everything. The Google generation is expert at using technology. Myths. Not all young people use the internet all the time. Older generations are less competent. Assumptions. Some engines are the preferred means of finding information. Search results are fit for purpose. Instant 24/7 access is expected, and search engines are more relevant to students. In 2011, IFLA had used the term wishes of users in place of needs of the users. The wishes of the present users are: number one, ease of access; number two, richness of content; number three, affordable service; number four, translation; and the last one is ease access to resource persons. Ease of access. Users would like to have as much content as possible online and remotely accessible from wherever they are using any device they have at hand. Ease of search access databases and available content assets, that is, users would like our search engines to be like Google, easy to use yet much better and more precise. Number two, richness of content. Users would like to have easy access to a very rich repository of content in all formats and languages 24/7. Number three, affordable services. Users are prepared to pay for service. However, they would like libraries to help them negotiate for lower fees and make the payment process easy and convenient. Translation: user would like content translated into the mother tongue languages that they understand. And the last one is access to resource persons or librarians who can help them to negotiate and provide suitable coaching when they need help. So, students, let's summarize what we have learned from this module. Librarians, users, and systems developers alike must cope with the changing and emerging technological environment to adequately respond to user needs. Librarians and information service providers must be careful to address the information needs of information seekers. They must avoid generalizing the needs and attempting to fulfill by providing the information seeker with basic information obtained within their library. Accommodate needs of tech-savvy users, and searching is always done in a context of information seeking by a user. Librarians create or facilitate online information resources from raw data and make it accessible. People accept that the librarian will assist them to find the information they need. They should teach them how to access, evaluate, and use resources on the information highway.